Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we have with us Professor David Reich, who has worked on whole human genome sequencing. His work is well known. We're going to discuss the methodological issues. What does human genome, the whole human genome sequencing, which is what you and your group has been one of the pioneers, how has it helped the study of ancient migrations?
If you can obtain whole genome sequences of similar quality to people living today from ancient bones and from ancient teeth from known archaeological contexts, where you know the types of pots people made, you know the types of buildings they were living in, archaeologists have studied the similarities or differences amongst cultures, you can then ask the question, were the people who lived in these sites related to people who lived in other sites that may or may not have similarities to them and to people living today? So we can ask the question, how do people, ancient people, relate to each other and to people living today? And we can ask the question, is the connection in material culture due to movement of people, or is it just due to sharing of ideas? And that's what it makes it possible to answer.
So a lot of the Fertile Crescent agriculture seems to have been both movement of people, but also movement of ideas.
I think so. I think that it's certainly in the case of the development of agriculture, it's clear that multiple groups that were quite different from each other spread. So for example, some of the first farming starts in Anatolia in present-day Turkey, and the people there genetically are quite different from the people in Western Iran, who are in turn quite different from people in the Levant, present-day Jordan and Israel. And yet all of those groups seem to have expanded along with the spread of farming, and domestication has potentially occurred in multiple places there. So it doesn't seem to be a single group developing agriculture, but instead a kind of multi-ethnic world where agriculture is developing and there's spread of people and there's also spread of ideas and technology that's independent of the spread of people or that's beyond the spread of people.
So some of the spread of the agricultural products, in that seeds and so on, seem to have taken place without migration of people, at least in large numbers. So you would see that this is more technologies being and knowledge being transferred rather than, in this particular case, genetic.
I think you see both things occurring. You see both things occurring. So for example, the place where we know this best is in Europe and the Near East, but especially in Europe, where we have lots and lots of whole genome sequences now from before and after the transition to agriculture and from before and after the transition, other transitions that happen later. And we can see that the arrival of agricultural lifestyle coincides with an arrival of new people. It's a one-to-one mapping. It's a perfect mapping initially in many places. And so whether that's this new way of life is coming with new people.
So this is the expansion that takes place from Anatolia to Europe?
That's right. So it comes in from Anatolia, agriculture spreads from Anatolia or maybe from Cyprus, or it's not totally clear where, but genetically the data from early farmers from Anatolia from 8.5 and 9,000 years ago is extremely similar to early farmers from Europe from a little bit later. And it's consistent with the idea that that's the source population.
And in Levant, as well as Anatolia, as well as Iran, Zagros Mountains, this, you see the spread of agriculture, but not really the spread of populations in the same way?
No, you do see that also. So after the initial period of the development of agriculture, you see all of these groups mix into each other. So for example, in Iran, you actually see a lot of Anatolian ancestry. And in Anatolia, you see a lot of Iranian ancestry. And in the Levant, you see a lot of Anatolian and Iranian ancestry. So you see all of these groups mixing into each other in different proportions in different places. But it's not one group pushing out the others. It's rather multiple groups mixing with each other, interacting with each other in ways that richly, interact with the archaeological knowledge. And so it's allowing us to quantify the process, those processes.
So this is the agriculture part. We're not discussing South Asia because your papers are under review and they have not been yet published. So there's, an embargo talking to the press on that. So let's focus more on the European publications or European migrations that took place from Asia. The second migration, which is also that you have worked on, is the Indo-European speakers or horse, shall we say, riding people coming into Europe. So where would that location be, roughly, according to your studies?
Right. So one of the things that we and others have documented with ancient DNA beginning in 2015 is that after this mass movement of people into Europe from the Near East via Anatolia probably after 9,000 years ago, there's another large-scale movement into Central and Western Europe that comes from a different source population that is, we think, is very likely to be or maybe the source is the this particular archaeologically defined group of people that's often called Yamnaya that lived in the steppes north of the Black and Caspian Seas. It's not clear that they were riding horses. There's a debate about whether they rode horses at all, and for example, but they certainly used domesticated horses very intensively, for at least for pulling things and maybe for milking things and maybe for eating.
And also chariots?
And not, definitely not yet. That's much later. So the first chariots are also from the steppe, but they're 1,000 years later. These people expand to the west and to the east leave a very profound demographic impact on Europe.
So these are the two major demographic impacts of the European stock, as it were. One is from the Anatolian agrarian people, and the other is the steppes people may or may not be horse riding, but associated with horses?
It's not even, yes, associated to horses. It's just not clear to what extent horses are important in their expansion or not. But, and then the third component of ancestry in Europe is the indigenous component, the hunter-gatherer component that mixes in a substantial way with these other three. But Europeans today are for the most part a mixture of these three source populations. First farmers from Anatolia, probably local indigenous hunter-gatherers and steppe pastoralists who come in after 5,000 years ago. And it's a mixture of those three sources in different combinations that contribute most to the variation in ancestry in Europe today.
So the demic expansion theory or model that was proposed by different historians and also demographers and so on. So that seems to hold good for agriculture, but if you come to the steppes population and language, then the Indo-European speakers are probably associated not with agricultural expansion, but with the steppes people.
I think it's highly likely that Indo-European languages track at least some extent with the expansion, present-day spoken Indo-European languages that track to some extent with Yamnaya steppe pastoralist ancestry. And the reason is that the spoken languages, it's sort of Yamnaya ancestry is a kind of tracer die for Indo-European languages. And so Indo-European languages are not spoken very much in the Middle East and the Near East there's very little steppe ancestry, and we see it spreading into Europe at a time that, well after the spread of agriculture, making a massive impact. It's hard to imagine that spread was not accompanied by language transition. And other lines of evidence also make the steppe a plausible source for the spread of Indo-European languages. There are Indo-European languages that are attested in the texts, Tocharian and Hittite. And in particular, it's quite possible that Hittite, which is ancient language of Turkey and other early Anatolian languages, don't have Yamnaya ancestry. So this is not a statement about the ultimate homeland of Indo-European languages, but rather late Proto-Indo-European, the languages that are spoken today.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank
Professor
you.
Reich, to be with us.
Thank you.
And we hope that you have a nice visit, stay, and discussions in Jaipur.
Thank you for your interest in my work. Thank you for coming to talk with me.